Zeal Church, it's been an incredible week being the hands and feet of Jesus as we've had over 700 people serving the city of Nashville. With 35 opportunities, we have been able to make a difference through local food distribution, painting, serving our community with block parties, handing out hundreds of backpacks with school supplies for families, and so much more. Thank you for being a part of Serve Week and making the invisible God visible in our city.
If everything in your life is peachy and keen and you sleep in silk sheets and get, you know, you're in a castle and every area of your life is all you do is win, win, win no matter what, then listen, today's sermon is not for you. You can check out, you can leave the auditorium. We need your seat anyway. If you're on YouTube, you can press pause and come back to this later. This message is for somebody who does not have total and entire victory in every area of their life just yet. This is for somebody who is in the middle of a battle and everything's not perfect yet. There's something in your marriage and it's a little bit of a battle, and if that's you, this sermon is for you. If everything in your family's not okay and there's some things with some relatives, and although you're praising the God and although you're worshiping our Lord, there's some things in your family that you know you're in the middle, you're in the thick of it, this sermon is for you. Somebody say it's for me. If in any area of your finance over the last 18 to 24 months, if you've experienced any economic downturn, this sermon is for you. Somebody say it's for me. If in your mind you have to wake up and fight for peace and you don't wake up with some cognitive set of butterflies and everything's perfect and you just walk around singing, how great is our God. If you don't wake up like that and you have to fight and have some coffee just to be a Christian, this sermon is for you. Somebody say it's for me. And so today I came, fighting season starts next week. Next week it will be as though we took our whole church family through a fight camp, which is how you prepare to fight. Here's why. I don't want you experiencing just the peace of God in a service on a Sunday. I don't want you just experiencing the presence and the victory that you find in Jesus on a Sunday. Victory in Jesus is not a song, it's a lifestyle. I want to teach you how to live in victory every day of your life. Can I get an amen? Amen. And so I'm fired up about it. Today I came to put hell on notice on behalf of your battle. That we are coming to fight. Somebody say, I'm coming to fight. Why don't you find a neighbor around you that looks like they need to pick a fight with you, look like they got a little bit of attitude, and tell them, knuckle up. Come on, tell somebody. Tell somebody. Put it in the chat. I'm here to fight. I came to pick a fight. Some of you are like, I thought this was a church. No, this is a boxing ring for about the next 3 months. Some of you would say this. In Christianity, the whole fight thing, I don't understand just yet. Or I'm not a fighter. I don't feel like I came to church this morning with boxing gloves on. I don't feel trained. I don't feel like I'm a boxer. I don't feel like I'm a fighter. I've been through a camp. I would just say, if you're not a fighter, you're not a fighter yet. Yeah. And today, by the power of the Holy Ghost, that's going to change in your life. Today, God is going to help you to learn and to see that there is a fighter within you. If you're looking for a title for today's sermon, it's The Faith to Fight. The faith to fight. Finding the faith to fight. Would you say it with me? Finding the faith to fight. Let's go to the central narrative in Scripture out of Judges chapter 6. If you wanted to read something this week and really unpack today's sermon, I would be up and down Judges 1 through Judges 6. Judges chapter 6, verse 11 and 12. If you see it on the screen, say, I see it. You don't see it. If you see it on the screen, say, I see it. All right, Judges chapter 6. This will give you an idea of the setting of where we are. Finding the faith to fight. The angel of the Lord came and sat down under the oak in Oprah. Some of y'all didn't know she was in the Bible. That belonged to Joash the Abizrite. Some of y'all got some Abizrites in your family. Can never admit they're wrong. That's part of that Abizrite clan, you know what I'm saying? Some of y'all got some friends right now. They can't even take notes. They're too busy being right all the time.
I be's right.
Where his son Gideon was threshing wheat in a wine press to keep it from the Midianites. The Midianites were an oppressive group of people that would wait just, they would camp outside the enemy lines and they would wait just until harvest season when you gathered all of the goods that you've been working for 9 months for, and then they would ravage the entire property, the entire land. It's the Midianites. When the angel of the Lord appeared to Gideon, he said, "The Lord is with you, mighty warrior." Somebody say warrior. Today we're trying to wake up the warrior. The Lord turned to him and said, "Go in the strength you have and save Israel out of Midian's hand. Am I not sending you? Pardon me," notice the sarcasm here. If I was God and you got sarcastic with me, I would slap the taste out of your mouth. Thank God he is gracious, amen. "Pardon me, my Lord," Gideon replied, "but how can I save Israel? My clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my family." The Lord said to him, "I will be with you," watch this, "and you will destroy the Midianites as if you were fighting against one man." Can we pray? Bow your heads, close your eyes. Father, thank you so much for Scripture. Father, I thank you, Lord, that all throughout Scripture, you teach us how to have faith to fight. Not every situation in our life requires kindness. Sometimes we have to learn to fight, and what we do not fight, we forfeit. So I pray, Father, throughout the body of Christ today that you would wake up the warrior inside of us. Father, we know that we have victory in you, but we want to walk in the victory. We want to receive and embody the victory we sing about. Father, we know that you promise peace, for instance, yet we have so many of our family and friends who struggle with anxiety. So guide us by your Spirit through the text today. And I pray that you would birth a fighter in each of us, that you would awaken the spirit of a fighter today, Father, because we know some things in life are worth fighting for. And everybody said amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let me start here. When it comes to the family of God, the church, everybody say the church. The church. The church is an organism, a living gathering of people started by Jesus. And there are many functions of the church, many functions. We are not a one-dimensional body. We are not a one-dimensional team. We're not a one-dimensional battalion. We have many functions as we embody Christ. One of the interesting functions that we have is an educational arm. That does not mean we are a school, but it means we have educational responsibility. For instance, Jesus during the Great Commission said, "I want you to go out into all the world, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey the commands. And I will be with you always." In other words, if you're with your own agenda, I won't be with you. But if you will teach them to obey the commands, I will be with you. You will sense the favor of God, the presence of God, if you'll teach them to obey the commands. So we have educational responsibility. We have a job to teach. And the goal of teaching isn't to produce a person that likes Christ. The goal of teaching is to produce a person that is Christ-like. Wow. How many of you know there's a difference between liking Christ and being Christ-like? When it comes to victory and walking in victory and living in victory and owning victory, victory is the life that faith produces of a person that is Christ-like. You are like Christ. That's why they called us Christians. We are like Christ. So when it comes to education and teaching, I want to admonish you this morning that it is not enough to learn and take notes. That as we learn, we are to take it to the next level and embody, body of Christ, embody who Christ is. That means his character has to over time become our character. His traits over time must become our traits. If Jesus talks like that, JD's got to learn to talk like that. If Jesus gave like that, JD's got to learn to give like that. We embody who Christ is. So as you look throughout the text, we have the living example. And then above the teachings, the walking of Jesus that we are to learn and live like, we have these domineering metaphors that help us visualize who Jesus is. You'll see this in 1 John chapter 1, verse 29. The first leading metaphor, if you will, gives us a picture of who Jesus is. It says, "The next day John saw," the revelator, "saw Jesus coming towards him and said, 'Look,'" can we say this together? "'The Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. Jesus is the Lamb of God. How many of you are thankful for the compassion and the grace and mercy? How many of you are thankful that Jesus is indeed the Lamb of God? Make some noise in the house of God. He's the Lamb of God. The Lamb speaks to his humility, his meekness. It speaks to his ability in a tough situation to be diplomatic. When others go high and haughty, it speaks to Jesus' ability to come low as a servant. The Lamb speaks to his ability to have a high level of commitment to sacrifice. Jesus is lamb-like, and so we too, saints, we're called to be lamb-like. And in this generation, I would say, we've leaned into that. I would say a positive over the last 25 years is the body of Christ, specifically here in the Western Hemisphere, is we have leaned into the compassion of Christ and perhaps been more generous and more willing to get out of the four walls and more willing to serve others, and we have became more lamb-like because Jesus is the Lamb of God. But he is not only a lamb. He is a lamb, but he is not only a lamb. And it is crucial to understand the different character and trait of who Jesus is, because if you show up to battle like a lamb, lambs don't win battles. And if you have an imbalance in understanding who Jesus is, it makes it easier to slide into error. Does that make sense? So it is crucial, and I know it is undertaught and underemphasized, but Jesus is a lamb. He is not just a lamb, according to Scripture. Another leading, domineering metaphor for Jesus is he is the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Humble in one moment, king in another moment. Let me show you in the text in case you don't believe me. Revelation chapter 5, once again, a view of Jesus. Then I saw on the right hand of him who sat on the throne a scroll with writing on both sides and sealed with seven seals. And I saw a mighty angel proclaiming in a loud voice, "Who is worthy to break the seals and open the scroll?" But no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth could open the scroll or even look inside it. I wept and wept because no one who was found worthy to open the scroll or look inside. Then one of the elders said, "Do not weep with this impossible task. See," let's read it together, "the Lion of the tribe of Judah." Another one, "the root of David has triumphed." Somebody say victory. "He," the Lion of the tribe of Judah, "is able to open the scroll and its seven seals." I'm here to announce and to preach and teach today that there are some jobs, some seasons in your life that only a lion can do. The lamb is meek and humble, and the lamb is meek. We are to be lamb-like, but we are not to only be lamb-like. We are also to be lion-like. A lion is powerful. Have you ever been to the zoo? And out of nowhere, you get scared because you hear a lion roar? They're powerful. They're a predator. They're resolute. They're fierce. You can mess with a lamb. I wish you would mess with a lion. You can pick on a lamb. You dare not pick a fight with a lion. I propose that a lamb went to the cross, but a lion got out of the grave. The Bible says he got out of the grave with all power in his hands. A lamb bid not the children to come. A lion cleared the temple when it was not clean. Jesus is both the Lamb of God and the Lion of the tribe of Judah. And when your back is against the wall, you need to choose to embrace not the lamb side, but the lion side. I propose that there's an entire generation that has never been introduced to the Lion of the tribe of Judah. And when your kids walk through a tough time, you can't lamb it all out. Sometimes you have to roar. When your marriage is walking through a tough time, you can't bat it out. Sometimes you got to battle it out. You can't show up to a fight with wool. You have to show up to fight as a warrior. Can I get an amen? And in your life, there are some times where you have to lean in as a lion. Mama, sometimes you gotta be a lioness. Sometimes you gotta snatch that teenager out of the addiction that they're in. Sometimes you have to pray a prayer that's not so kind. Sometimes you have to storm the gate of the enemy and say, you can't have my kids, you can't have them, they're not yours. I came to get it, because I'm not just a lamb, I'm a lion. Can I get an amen? You will have a hard time believing Christianity if you only believe in the compassion of it. King David, Goliath came up to King David. He said, you come at me with the sword? Oh, I got you. I came in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and I will cut off your head today, because you've been pursuing the Israelites, and those are God's people, and you can't mess with God's people. That's right. Yeah. Jesus is a lamb, and Jesus is a lion. Yeah. And in the text in Judges chapter 6, you have the massive oppression of God's people. And just like in your life, when you have been oppressed and you have been beaten down and your joy has went missing and the unity in your marriage has went missing, you feel oppressed and you feel like you're overcome by the enemy, like there is a black cloud over your house or over your apartment. What you need is a fight. And so this is what we see in the text, because all of Israel, listen to this, all of Israel's deliverance depends on a fighter showing up. That's why God loved David. He wasn't perfect, but he was willing to fight. Are you willing to fight for things worth fighting for? We'll see in the text right here. I want you to see the first line and the last line. Judges chapter 6, it says, because the power of Midian was so oppressive. Now, later on in your reading, I want you to read how they were oppressive and how, just like Satan is a thief that comes to steal, kill, and destroy, so were the Midianites to God's people. They'd be in the middle of harvest season, looking forward to what could be, and they would come in and steal everything, steal all of their goods, and now they were oppressed. And at the end of the text, God speaks to Gideon. He says, the Lord is with you, mighty warrior. Here we are in the worst of times. We're being oppressed, and yet God speaks in the middle of the battle. See, God does not take you out of the battle. God mostly takes you through battles. God says, in the middle of the battle, when you are underground, not on the battleground, underground, you are not fighting, you have farm equipment in your hand. God says, I see not a farmer, I see a warrior. And some of you need to learn to thank God for the battle that you are in right now, because it is the Midianites' oppression, and it is that battle that unearths the warrior that he did not know he was. You have to learn to thank God for the battle, because God is saying to Gideon, there's something stronger in you than you know you have. And if you don't have a battle, you may never wake up the fighter, the warrior. You may never experience the victory that you sing, pray, and believe about. So a great gift to Gideon is his enemies. You ought to thank God for the haters that said you couldn't do it. You ought to thank God for the people in your life who counted you out. Because it is not until you have been pressed on, where you have been depressed, that you experience that Jesus Christ, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, is indeed inside of you. And you can only back a lion in a corner for so long. Come on, somebody. Where the mamas at? Ooh, you touch one of my kids. You touch one of my... Leah Joe. Listen, if you touch one of my kids... That little sweet blonde on the front row, it will do for her what a phone booth does for Clark Kent. That girl will come out scratching and clawing and kicking. Them high heels will come off and she'll stab you in the eye. Don't mess with them kids, because my baby is Southern and she knows how to fight. Somebody say fight. Where's all the loyal friends in the house? You ain't gonna talk about my friend. I wish you would. We got enough people around here can poke the problems. I need somebody to come around me and say, I know the hill's tough. Let's go get that hill. Yeah. Somebody say fight. Fight. When there's a battle, fighting is necessary. Yeah. There is no Christianity without a fight. There's a fight in Genesis and there's a fight in Revelation. There's fight all throughout the text. Jesus came to overcome the enemy. That's a fight. Somebody say fight. And when there's a fight, fighting is necessary. Amen. When there is a war, you becoming and embodying who Christ is and becoming a warrior is necessary. Yes. You can't kindly pray yourself through every problem. Sometimes you have to learn to rebuke the enemy. Some of you need to learn how to have a spiritual, you know, slap, punch, kick, elbow. Why? Why do you need to learn to fight? Because this generation, you know, I heard a guy say that good times make weak men. That if it's been good, you settle into good because you did not have to earn the grit by getting good because you've been in good times. So you don't have the grit and the muscle that it takes to earn good times. So good times make weak men. Why do you have to learn to fight? For your family, for your peace, for your mind, for your business, for your friends. Why do you have to learn to fight? Here's why. Because victory is promised. Did you know that the 7,000 promises in this scripture, according to Galatians chapter 3, are for you? Peace is a promise God intends to keep in your life. Did you know healing is a promise God intends to keep in your life? Did you know hope and faith and love, healing in your marriage, reconciliation, deliverance is a promise that God has for you? But here's what I've learned about promises. Promises have to be possessed. The truth is, God has promises for you, but not every believer experiences the promises they believe in. Just because you believe in a promise doesn't mean that you get to experience that promise. And the bridge that connects the promise of God with your experience, that is called faith. That's why I'm saying it takes faith to fight, because a promise is something that is yours that you don't have yet. God promises that if you train up a child in the way that they go, they will not depart. For some of you, it's hard to believe that because not depart is a prodigal right now. So you have to have faith to possess the promise that is yours, but not yours yet. Victory is promised, but whatever is promised must be possessed. For instance, with the promised land, it's called Canaan land. Do you know why? Because it is currently occupied by the Canaanites. And what I've learned in my own life is if I am unwilling to overthrow the opposition, I can sing about a promise I never possess. So you have to learn to fight. Somebody say, learn to fight. Joshua chapter 1. Moses is dead and God speaks directly to Joshua and says, be strong. He didn't say feel strong. He said, be strong. And every place that you put your foot, I'll give you. Now that's a promise. Here's the problem. We have spent way too much time in the body of Christ teaching and preaching promise and not possessing. Because if you read the next 13 chapters after the promise of God, the next 13 chapters are 31 wars. Right. Yeah. You want those kids to be raised up in the body of Christ and be called and know God and never lose their virginity before marriage and never get trapped in anxiety and depression and drugs? You have to fight to possess the promise that God promised you. Yeah. If we aren't willing to overthrow the opposition, we can't possess what God's promised. That's why you have to learn how to fight. Those that fight are letting me know something. If you fight for your marriage, it lets me know that you believe God has hope for your marriage. Amen. Somebody that's a fighter, see, here's what I've learned about God's people. If they don't believe joy is theirs, they will never fight for it. They will think that it is my lot in life to never be on the receiving side of joy. So then they will cope with anxiety the rest of their life, never believing that the promise of joy is theirs. If you don't believe that healing, that the stripes on Christ's back provide healing for your body, if you don't believe that promise, you will never fight to possess it when you get a diagnosis. You have to learn to fight with faith. Somebody say fight. If you don't believe that peace is yours, you'll just learn to live in angst. If you don't believe that you've been forgiven, then you allow Satan, the enemy of your life, to remind you of your past, and you will live in guilt, although you've been forgiven. You have to learn to fight. Everybody say fight. For what has been promised. You have to possess. God gives it to you, but you have to go get it. Now, here's a question. Okay, I have to have faith. What is faith? The evidence of things I haven't seen. So God promised it to me, but I have to have faith to go fight for it. What if I lose my fight? What if I don't feel like I can fight? What if I've been through just enough life to realize I don't know if I can fight anymore? You ever been there? You ever been in a place like, man, I've been fighting for marriage pastor for 22 years. I can't even hear it anymore. This dude hadn't taken me on a date night in 14 years. And you tell me to fight. I've already fought. Or maybe for you, it's a diagnosis you've had for a decade. And you're like, when I first got saved, I was shouting that thing down. God is my healer. I believe he'll heal me. By his stripes, I'm healed. Get up off of me, Satan. And you are fired up. And then year two, year three, year four, you stop fighting. The Midianites have been so oppressive that you've put down your sword and picked up farm tools. Lay down your calling to be comforted in the middle of the battle. You see this in the text. Let me show you in the text. It's Judges chapter 6, verse 14. The Lord turned to him and said, go in the strength you have and save Israel out of Midian's hand. Am I not sending you? Pardon me, Lord, Gideon replied, but how can I save Israel? Notice his response to God saying, hey, it's time to fight. All of your people, your relatives are being oppressed by Satan, the Midianites. It is time to fight. Notice his response when he's been oppressed, been through some things. Here's his response. But how can I save Israel? My clan is the weakest in Manasseh, and I am the least in my family. If you've been attacked enough, if you've woke up enough with anxiety for months or years, if your marriage has struggled, your relationships have struggled long enough, if you have been oppressed by the enemy long enough, oftentimes our response to God's call to fight is met with, I'm inadequate. Just like Gideon would say, God, I don't have it. Have you ever realized that you needed to stand up and fight for a relationship and you just didn't have the breath in your lungs to do it? You ever got so tired of fighting for a relationship that you just like, whatever. Wave your hand in the air like you just do care. Yeah. You ever tried to understand scripture, like go hard in the paint and like read the Bible and you just run out of energy, run out of hope, run out of steam? How do you get faith back to fight? How do you get your faith back to fight? Because I'm gonna tell you right now, the promises of God are yes and amen, but they require you to possess them. And a lamb does not go and snatch new territory. That's a lion's job.
Wow. All right. So good.
When your family's going through something and everybody's terrified, it is the lamb that hugs them. But it is the lion that charges hell and bombards hell with the promises of God. It is the lamb that cries and weeps with those who are weeping. It is the lion that comes alongside them and says, you shall not die, saith the Lord. God has a word for you. God has a plan for you. You're too young to die. There's purpose for you. You have to show up as a lamb. But ladies and gentlemen, you have to show up also as a lion. But how do you get the faith if you don't have the faith to fight? If you've been through something and you've been oppressed at all, how do you get the faith to fight? Because you're called to fight. You're called to serve and be compassionate, but you are also called to fight. There are some things worth fighting for. In our culture, in our society, in our family, there are some things worth fighting for. Let's go to the text. I love what the Lord said. It said, the Lord said, go in the strength. Ooh, this is a mouthful. I don't know how to do it. I'm down here doing farm stuff. I'm hiding. You're calling me up from the underground to the battleground. How am I supposed to? I'm not trained. We have no proof that Gideon is trained as a warrior. God is seeing the warrior that Gideon doesn't see in himself. The greatest threat to the Israelites wasn't the Midianites. The greatest threat to the Israelites was Gideon's inability to believe what God said. God calls me a warrior. The greatest battle that Gideon has is believing that Gideon was a warrior and that he could defeat all the Midianites. The Midianites aren't the problem. It's, do you believe God? Do you believe that he will give you victory? Because what he says is, watch this, go in the strength you have. I love this. I love this. Let me tell you why. It does not say, go in the strength I'll give you. It does not say, go through a training camp, get strong, and then I'll use you on the battlefield. It does not say, go in the strength you wish you had. Gideon's like, I got this much strength. You know what God says? That'll do. You got a little bit of strength, you got a little bit of fight in you, that's all you need. The strength that you currently have today is all that you need to step onto the battleground and receive victory. God says, because of who you're walking with, all you need to do is pick up a sword. You ain't got to be King David yet. You ain't got to figure it out. You don't have to be strong like Samson, Gideon. I knew you when I called you, and if I called you, you have the grace to win. Whatever you have, baby, it's enough. Get up and fight. Somebody make some noise. Where are my fighters at? Where are my fighters at? Fight. Fight for that marriage. Fight for that peace. Fight for that job. You gotta fight. Too much timid Christianity. You want joy? You gotta fight for joy. You gotta wake up every day and say, the joy of the Lord is my strength. I don't feel like it. It doesn't look like it. It's cloudy outside. Netflix got canceled. But who is ever against me? No weapon formed against me will prosper. I've got joy and unspeakable joy and full of glory. You gotta fight. What do I need? He said, go in the strength you have. I ain't got much strength right now. God says, okay, that'll do. Yeah. I've been worn out by the Midianites. I'm running on 3%. God said, that'll do. Why? Watch this. He says, the Lord answered, go in the strength you have and save Israel out of his hand. Am I not sending you? Watch this. He does not argue with the illogical excuses of him being the least. He does not argue with him and say, no, you're not the least, you're the best. You know why? Your insecurities are illogical. He did not argue with him, he ministered to him. He did not argue and say, no, you're not the least, you're the best. He said, no, I'm reminding you of who's going with you. And if the lion is going with you, whatever strength you have is all the strength you need to get every victory you need. How many of you guys know you walk a little bit different into battle when there is the lion of the tribe of Judah on your hip? Come on, if you believe, God gives you victory. Whatever you got's enough. Whatever fight you have is enough, according to Scripture. It reminds me when I was a freshman. When I was a freshman in high school, I was 5'3", same size head. And true story. And when I was a freshman, I played quarterback, and I was a little bitty guy, and so I would get picked on by the upperclassmen. They would wear me out. I mean, just pick on the little, you know, you have to haze their way into varsity. And I'll never forget, man, they were kind of picking on me, and it was kind of hard to show up to practice and stuff like that. And I remember one day, there was a guy named Debo. How many of you guys know you need a Debo in your life? 6'7", 350, went to Notre Dame. He'll put your lights out and can move like a cat. And he took a liking to me. And we were in a locker room and he told me this, they will never pick on you again as long as I'm with you. How many of you guys know when Debo was there, I walk a little different. I felt the Holy Ghost told me to tell you, you need to walk different because the lion of the tribe of Judah is beside you. You ought to put your shoulders back. You ought to head into that battle knowing that victory is in Jesus and victory is yours because there's a lion who's never lost, who is undefeated. Is there anybody under the sound of my voice who's as experienced that Jesus Christ can do it all? He can heal it. He can set you free. He can deliver you. He can sustain you. Jesus is the lion of the tribe of Judah. You can't fight sitting down. Last thing. I got 2 more hours of notes and we're done. But I got to show you something. We'll start fight season next week. Some of you are like, he's fired up. Yeah, on behalf of your future, you ain't just a lamb. You are a lion. Christ-like, lion-like. Matthew chapter 11, verse 12, and the righteous taketh by force. There's some things you gotta take. There's some things you gotta snatch. You got a friend dipping down right now in alcoholism? Fight him out. You take some scriptures and you pray, oh God, I wish you would just take away the tequila, Lord. Kind of prayers ain't getting nothing done. You gotta charge hell. You gotta push back the enemy's camp and say, devil, you can't have him. He's been set free and delivered. He's got purpose. He will live his life sober. He's gonna be a good father. We take it off. Break the stronghold. Break the stronghold. You gotta fight. Now, what's interesting, I gotta go. Y'all are messing with me this morning. Somebody say fight. Somebody say fight. Jesus is called affectionately the Lion of the Tribe of Judah. Tribe means house or households. Look up the word Judah. You know what Judah means? Praise. So Jesus is the Lion of the House of Praise, which makes sense now because in the Old Testament, what preceded every victory in battle were shouts of praise. And every time the battlefield needed to be overturned and the atmosphere needed to be changed and victory needed to come for God's people, the victory was preceded by a sound. How many of you guys know a lion has a powerful sound? I wonder for about 2 minutes, I know fighting season starts next week. I wonder if we can take about 2 minutes and alert the enemy and stand to our feet and give the type of praise that starts to allow victory to come into your life. Victory has a sound. Victory has a sound. Yeah. That's the sound that breaks chains. That's the sound that alerts heaven. That's the sound that bursts a fighter in you. That's the sound that brings the prodigal home. That's the sound where all of heaven stands at attention. That's the sound that'll cancel cancer. That's the sound that will cancel anxiety. Give God some praise. Come on, praise him until the room changes. Praise him until you feel victory. Praise the Lord. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. He inhabits the praise of his people. Come on, 10 more seconds. Praise the Lord. I'm gonna get in this thing. If you know somebody that you love and they're lost right now and they're hurting, I don't care if it's just you. I want you to lift up a shout of praise and fight for them right now. Go. If you know somebody that needs healing right now, I need you to fight for them. Come on, fight. Hallelujah. Shout to God. If you know somebody that needs a touch from God, shout on their behalf. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Sometimes you gotta shout it out. Every time in the Old Testament. See, if you've only been taught lamb-like Christianity, a shout offends you. I'm in it now. I don't care if the cars wait online. I gotta preach this. Listen. I grew up with a mama who, when I would go on the other side of town and get wrapped up in the wrong people and dating the wrong girl, I would come home to a mama shouting that girl out of my life. You can't whisper some things out. Some of y'all have bold dreams but timid prayers. God says you need to learn how to fight. You need to straighten your back, straighten your shoulder, learn to lift your voice. I know it's awkward when you first started clapping. I grew up singing Baptist. All this is crazy to me. but I've learned some things are worth fighting for. So for 10 more seconds, I need you to set the tone and atmosphere of this room before next weekend that we're gonna start seeing victory in Jesus.